This is Tito Jackson. Come check out my interview with Pascal Achimed, Norfi, first on Black Culture.
Tito Jackson.
Good morning.
It's a real pleasure to have you with us today.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here.
You're an American singer, songwriter, and guitarist.
Yes.
You are the third child in the Jackson family. And
yes,
And with your brothers, Jackie, Jermaine, Marlon, and Michael, you founded in the 1960s, the Jackson 5, a pop band famous for releasing songs like ABC. I Want You Back. Oh, baby, give me one more chance. Or Can You Feel It? Tito, how did the Jackson 5 get created? Because it is said that it is when you sneakily took your father's guitar that the Jackson family band started.
Well, there's a few true stories surrounding that whole time period. Actually, I have to give credit to Mom as well, because she used to love to sing country music, and Jermaine and Jackie and myself used to harmonize with her. You know, we used to always sing a song called Country Feels Back Home. Mm-hmm. And we would do the harmony parts, because we learned how to harmonize from watching the Three Stooges. Yeah, they used to always go, hello, hello, hello. So we would do that and make harmonies. And we start singing this country song called Cotton Feels Back Home. As my mother used to wash dishes, mm-hmm. we would be singing this song with her. Right. And my father was playing guitar with his brother, Uncle Luther mm-hmm. Jackson. And Luther would come over every weekend. Luther would come over with his guitar now. And my father would have his musical equipment, and they would jam. And I would sit there as a little boy and just stare and watch and enjoy what they were doing, wanting to do that, you know, because I was the kid that always wanted to be like my papa, mm-hmm. you know, everything he did, I wanted to be a part of it or do it as well. Like, he loved fishing. I'm the only brother that fishes. He loved construction. I remember my father built a hi-fi cabinet, and I was so impressed with it. I do construction and stuff like that. I contracted 5 projects. And so him being a musician and playing that guitar, mm-hmm. I was interested. So he used to say, when he'd go to work at Inland Steel Mill, he used to say, I'm going to work now, boys. Now listen, I'm putting my guitar in the closet, in the case. None of you better not touch it. Don't touch my guitar. And me being the kid I was, wanting to be like him so bad, my mother would let me play it, you mm-hmm. know, I, in the beginning, you know, so I had already had some ideas in my head. I saw the fingering on some of the easier stuff they were doing in the blues area. So I would practice that stuff. I would go out and take this guitar and practice for hours until my fingers had blisters on them. Mm-hmm. My thumb was full of pus and everything else. And I did this for months. And one time, I took the guitar out of the closet and I was playing it and trying to do some lead things and other stuff. And I broke the string.
Whoa.
I broke the string. Uh-huh. And I didn't know how to change a guitar string then. And I didn't even know the string name that I broke. So I was very afraid. My mom said, it's all right. Just put the guitar up and I'll talk to your father about it.
All right.
Okay, my father came home, and he noticed his guitar string was broke. He hit the fan.
Mm-hmm.
He put us all in the living room and sat us down and said, who's been playing my guitar? I started crying. So he knew it was me. He said, get in the room. I got in the room, and of course he beat my butt. Mm-hmm. And then he, after that, I came back into the living room. He took the guitar, had replaced the string, put the guitar in my lap and said, here, show me what you know. So I'm playing these songs and I'm crying at the same time.
Yeah.
And he looks at my mother and say, Kate, this boy really can play, huh? She said, Joe, I told you, he's not playing with your guitar. He really wants to be able to play the guitar. Mm-hmm. And he's doing it. So my father said, I tell you what, I'm going to give you this here guitar. I'll get myself another one. I'll give you this guitar, but I want you to learn every song you hear on the radio that you like. So I start listening to Motown and James Brown and all the other artists, Isley Brothers, all the artists in that era, learning their songs. So I would be in the bedroom playing these songs, and Jackie and Jermaine come in, they singing with me, you know, because they know the lyrics, because they're very popular songs on the radio. And we start singing, and as a group, this mm-hmm. is, it was just Jackie, Jermaine, and myself, the three brothers.
Yeah, at this time you were the Jackson Three, right?
Yeah, we didn't have a name.
Okay,
we
all right.
We was just three young boys, you know, experiencing what we hear on the radio, enjoying what we were doing, along with the guitar playing and the songs I knew and the singing those country songs with my mother. We were able to perform that. Mm-hmm. Michael and Marlon were little babies then. At then, I think Michael must have been no more than 4 or 5, and Marlon a year older. They used to be playing around and kidding and all kind of stuff, and we tell them to get out the room, begging us to be in the group. Can we be in the group? We want to. We tell them to get out. You're too young. Because,
mm-hmm.
You know, I'm 5 years older than Michael, you know, and I'm 2 years younger than Jackie. So they basically were playing with little toy, rolling little toy trucks around the ground or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then there was one day that Michael had a play or something, and he was singing in this play. So we all were at the play. It was the elementary school, and he started singing. And we couldn't believe what we were hearing. You know, his voice was so pure and beautiful, on tune, on key. And we didn't even know that he could sing like that.
Yeah, it was like a discovery. You were discovering something.
Yes, he was just begging to be in the group, but not singing. Not saying nothing, not saying I can sing too. Listen, he didn't say anything. He just begged to be in the group. We tell him, you know, you're interrupting our rehearsals or our practice or whatever. So anyway, when we heard him sing at Garnett Elementary School in Gary, Indiana, we immediately told him he was in the group. Marlon said, me too? Say, you too, Marlon, both of y'all.
Mm-hmm.
So then we had five members. And how we got the name the Jackson Five
mm-hmm.
is after we had formed a band. And my father actually learned that we could sing. And he started grooming us, sharpening us up, rehearsing us, putting us on schedules. And I want you boys to learn this song. When I get back from work today, I want it to be choreography, and I want you to perform this song for me or whatever. So we would do that all while his work. We'd be working on that song, getting dance moves, getting the singing together and all those things. He come home from work, we have it all together, you know. So from that, we went into doing weddings and birthday parties and little things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And one time we were in this talent show, and this lady came to us, little lady, white lady, and said, what's the name of you guys' band? Now, I think it was one of the brothers said, we don't have a name, you know, because we didn't have a name then.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, you don't have a name for your band? We said, no, we just sing. So she said, well, your last name is Jackson. And there's five of you. Why don't you just call yourself Jackson Five? That's how the Jackson 5 name came.
Okay, okay. And how did you end up signing up to Motown back in March 1969?
Well, we had signed to Motown before that. We had sent them tapes and stuff, but we never heard back from them. One time we were at the Regal Theater in Chicago, and we were on the amateur night, but they also have on amateur night, they have a professional artist. So I think it was Jackie Wilson that day. And we were on the talent portion of that show. It was almost like the opening act, like they have the talent show things, maybe like 5 or 6 different acts. Then they bring in the star, Jackie Wilson. So we was on that show. And I think Bobby Taylor was on that show as well. Mm-hmm. And he said he was, now I'm not sure, is it Bobby Taylor or Gladys Knight was the first one to see us as artists. It's one of those two. And they asked us to come over to Motown. I'm gonna present this to Barry and this whole thing. And we still didn't hear back from them. We never heard back from them. Mm-hmm. So we basically continued to sing, of course. Then the second time came around when another Motown artist was on the show with us. And I can't remember. I think it was Bobby Taylor the second time and Gladys the first time. But anyhow, he said, I'm going to take you over to Motown and get you guys an audition and this and that and that and this. Mm-hmm. So basically, we were a month or so later, we were at the Apollo Theater in New York. Mm-hmm. We were performing at the Apollo Theater.
Yep.
And we had an opportunity to go on to David Frost or Dick Cavett, one of those shows back then. Or we also, at the same time, we had an offer to audition for Motown.
Okay.
So we didn't know what to do. My feeling was, if we do the Dick Cavett show, we'll be seen by the nation. You know, every record company will have the opportunity to see the Jackson 5. But we were such Motown lovers, the rest of the brothers wanted to go with Motown.
Yeah.
You know, because of the Temptations and the Miracles, you know, Marvin Gaye, all these great songs that were floating over the radio at the time period. So anyway, to make a long story short, we wind up going to Detroit for an audition. Mm-hmm. And so we are over at the Motown office of Michigan, and they have this room. We set up our stuff, and, you know, the Motown staff comes in to see the group. Mm-hmm. You know, Berry Gordy's there. He's standing in the corner. Not saying too much, just waiting for the music to start, trying to see what's so great about these kids. Because he didn't want to sign another kid group because he had Stevie Wonder with all the laws and he can only work 3 hours at this time. Now he got to go to school. Can't work this kid past 6 hours a day or whatever. But he just didn't want to deal with it. You know, one was hard. He didn't want 5. So anyway, we continue. We go and we start to audition. And he's sitting in the corner. You know, we finish the song. Mm-hmm. We, you know, sort of sneakily looking at him, trying to see his expression. He's showing no expression whatsoever. We're wondering if he likes us or not, mm-hmm. You know. So anyway, we go to the next song, the next song, the next song. Anyway, when we finish our set, he walks over to us and he said, I'm going to make your first three songs go number one.
Okay. All right.
We knew we were in then. And he didn't only make three songs. He made four songs go number one.
Which ones?
I Want You Back. Oh, baby, give me one more chance. Show me that love you want to, please. ABC. The Love You Say. And I'll Be There. He said, I'm going to make your first three songs go number one. Mm-hmm. We said, great, great. We were all excited or whatever. And he said, and tomorrow I'm throwing a birthday party because it's Diana Ross's party. His or her birthday. Mm-hmm. And I want you guys to perform at the party, he said. So we were all excited. So we go over to his house. He has a pool, indoor pool, where the party was. Had the stage set up, everything. And here we are, we're performing these Motown songs. But at the party was Marvin Gaye, Diana Ross, all the Motown roster. And we're singing their songs, nervous as heck. And they all enjoyed it. And from that point, we went into the studio, did our first records with Bobby Taylor. Mm-hmm. Then Motown at that time, they were moving to California. And they wanted us to come over and make that move as well. So we did. And mm-hmm. that's when we got with the corporation producing team. And that's where I Want You Back in ABC came from. And we're in the studio, and the rest is pretty much history.
Okay. And so how did you all experience this life change from living in Gary, Indiana, to settling down in L.A.?
Well, it was quite exciting, you know, because, well, first of all, we had been traveling over the eastern part of America, mm-hmm. the Northeast, I would say more like Philadelphia, Washington, D.C., New York, Cleveland, Ohio, Indiana, Chicago, Peoria, Illinois. You know, that region was ours. We owned it. Everybody knew pretty much, you know, knew who the Jackson brothers were, these singing kids. So moving out, going to all these cities, it was exciting to see a palm tree is when we moved to California. Everything was different. You had hippies, you had palm trees, Sunset Boulevard, Whiskey A Go Go. Seeing all these things that you read about and see on TV, you know, it's quite exciting. And we fitted in pretty much because we were sort of used to traveling a little. So we just basically did our work. And we were at the age, same, we had immediate friends because Berry Gordy had children that was the same age as we are. Mm-hmm. So we became friends with them, and we used to go over to Berry's house all the time and swim over to Gladys' place, and not Gladys, over to Diana Ross' place because she didn't live too far away. We'll walk from one house to the other and just enjoy the swimming. We'd be at Berry's house, and we'd get a phone call that Diana Ross just made lunch for us. So we go back to her house, have lunch, and things like that. You know, it was great. It was a great time period.
But Tito, you and your sibling were always on tour all around the globe, apparently living the life of rock stars. What type of childhood and adolescence did you have?
My childhood was very, very narrow. Mm-hmm. The biggest part of my childhood that I remember that other children did is I got to play Little League baseball for 1 year when I was about 10 years old. And I'll never forget that because it was a lot of fun. But other than that, everything's been music, 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 show business, music, show business, music. It's been that road. Once I got on that road, it has been nothing since. you know, we were child stars. Mm-hmm. You know, I think when I Want You Back came out, I was 14 or 15. And from that point on, even up to making the music, you know, it was nothing but working.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't realize how hard we were working or how famous we were as kids. Being kids, you know, we just did the work. We wasn't mature enough to figure out what was really going on with our lives. We just did what Motown wanted or my father wanted or whatever they wanted. That's what we did. You know, without, because we are already raised to do just what adults and respect adults and things of that nature. So we just did the work.
Okay, and speaking about Michael, what kind of child was your brother Michael?
Well, Michael had less childhood than all of us.
Right.
He and Marlon, because they were younger when they became professional. I think when Michael sung I Want You Back, he was only 9 to 10 years old, you know. And being 9 to 10 years old, having the number one record in America or around the world, that's a big thing. That takes a lot of work and responsibility. He didn't have time to be a child, you know. I used to feel sorry because I was the type of person that I would go into a bar and sit with my friends or whatever. You know, I didn't do it often, but I had been to places like that. Mm-hmm. Well, Michael never experienced that kind of thing. You know, and he may have done it later in life after he was very famous, but he never really experienced that type of thing.
Right. So. And musically speaking, Michael has been named the King of Pop, and he's even been named the greatest entertainer that ever lived. So I'm quoting Berry Gordy during the funeral of Michael. So at what point were you, Tito, aware that your little brother would have become so famous and successful?
Well, put it this way. Like when I told you I heard him sing at Garnet, I knew he was something special then. You know, I used to look at Michael sideways and say, how do he do that? What makes this beautiful sound come out, his voice? I couldn't understand it being so young. Michael was born to do what Michael do. Michael is a workaholic, a genius in music. He was everything that was said that made him who he is as far as a great entertainer. He just always had it. You know, some people have it and some people don't. You know, Michael had everything it took to be the person he was. And I always just knew that he was going to be the best or the greatest entertainer that ever lived. Because he had such a jump start on everyone, you know. And he was serious about his craft and a workaholic. So with those combinations, you're doomed for success.
Of course. Like he got the gift of God and he worked it, he was serious, and that we can see the result, right?
Right, and I think all the brothers pretty much did that. I think that's a common thread that flows through the brothers. We all were workaholics, you know. We all just worked our butts off, actually.
Yeah. There's no secret. And speaking about your family members, what type of father was Joe Jackson? Because, you know, was he as mean and disciplinarian as he got portrayed in the TV movie about the Jackson 5?
Well, the TV movie was dramatized for TV. You know, my father wasn't the best. Well, I shouldn't use the word best. I just use the word. He wasn't always the kindest father. Of course, back then you got your butt whooped. And when you didn't listen or you did something that was terrible, you get your butt beat. You know, and it might not always be your father that beat your butt. It might be the neighbor across the street or next door.
Old school style.
My father, one thing I dug about my father was a real man. You know, we have a lot of people that's calling themselves a man today. They're not really men. You know, my father was a real man. He meant what he said. He said a man is only as good as his handshake. You know, and he just called things the way they were, you know, as far as what I know. You know, he grew up as a tough guy, and, you know, he worked in the steel mill, and he did the things that men do. You know, he was the type of father when he used to tell us, I want all these weeds pulled out of this yard when I get back home from work. I want to see a clean yard, and that's what we better do, or else, you know? I've always said that's one of the things the kids don't have. They don't have those type of chores. They don't have the kind of parents that to discipline them correctly. A guy go rob a bank and the parents just talks to him. What is that going to do?
Yeah. So you know? I see exactly what you mean. I see what you mean. And Tito, among the meetings you made, do you have memories of the one with reggae ambassador Bob Marley in Jamaica back in 1975? Because I remember that I heard that you did the open for Marley and his band at the National Heroes Stadium.
Right. I remember that. Mm-hmm. I remember opening up for Bob Marley and the Wailers. And we did go visit the camp and met Bob and took pictures and all that together. And he was very, very, he's a nice guy. Mm-hmm. Now, Bob Marley was a nice man, you know, and we loved him. We loved his music and what he stood for. And we still respect his song and who he is. You know, he's another legend. I put him up there with MJ, you know. It's a different genre of music, but he's definitely the king of reggae, you know?
And in the 1960s, 1970s, the Jackson 5 were a mythical band. And did you experience racism during this time? You as the Jackson 5? Really?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You always experience that. This happened a few times to us. I remember one time we were on a talent show before we even were professionals, and we outright bluntly won this talent show. They didn't give us, they gave us second place, and second place was something like a color TV or something. First place was the big prize. I think first place you get to audition for a company, record company or something like that. I says, at least we got a TV. My father said, look, like what I said, because he said, TV, this TV gonna get old and it's not gonna work sometime. I probably have to spend money. We need a record contract. That's where's that, you know, pretty much is what he was saying. And they gave the award to the white band.
Right.
Yeah. And when we used to go on the road, after the hit time, they used to always put our rooms in the back of the hotels where the garbage trucks come and the trash is being delivered, you know. So you waking up early, 6, 7 in the morning hearing trash trucks and rolling around big garbage bins and all that. So that kind of thing. And I remember one time Michael got chased out of a pawn shop, antique pawn shop down south. The guy was claiming Michael go in the shop and, you know, check out merchandise, pick it up, look at it. The guy said, put it back. Michael said, I like this. I might want to buy it. He said, no, put it back. He wouldn't let him touch anything and he would watch him. And the next thing I know, they had Michael in the back saying that he was trying to steal something. Now, our security that used to travel with us is a L.A. detective. Of course, he showed his badge and told them that is not true. This is this, told them who Michael was and this and that. And then when the guy finished, he felt very, very embarrassed because he could have probably made a couple of hundred bucks or more he was basically throwing it out the window, saying that my brother was being basically inoperative or whatever, how he was trying to steal or whatever he was trying to say. Mm-hmm. And well, we all know that was not the case. And that it was just prejudice to see. The guy probably wasn't used to seeing someone of color come into his shop and spending a few $100. He probably never had that, you know. But it does happen.
The Jackson 5 are also known for wearing an Afro hairstyle. Was this choice part of a marketing strategy, or was it more a sign of protest?
Well, it was basically what people were doing for the time. It was during the civil rights times and Black and I'm Proud, that whole thing. Black people grew their hair out to a natural thing, and that's what the brothers did, basically. We were just going with the time of the times.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah.
And why did the Jackson 5 split up?
I don't think the Jackson 5 ever split up. Michael would have told you today if he was still here. He's still mm-hmm. part of the Jackson 5. What had happened is basically that Michael's success was so tremendous. And with these companies, you know, of course, they're going to go with what's going to make the dollar. We got put on the back burner mm-hmm. and pretty much and was on standby. We had never been out on tour without a full group as such as our lead singer. So we didn't tour. Brothers didn't tour for almost 25 years or more. So at that time when he was going to do the O2 arenas, basically we were supposed to join that whole episode later in the game. We were supposed to join Michael and continue from there, you know, to arena. Mm-hmm. But that never happened, as you know.
Yeah, that's what I heard. Because everyone went solo. And what about you? What did you do? And why did you wait up to December 2016 to release your first studio solo album, Tito Time? What you want, what you want.
Tito Time, let me say it this way. Mm-hmm. At the time, back in the 70s, when Jackson 5 was really hot, Motown was doing records on Jackie and Jermaine and Michael, and then they was doing me. But we had left Motown. I never did get to complete my album. Mm-hmm. So what had happened is I had gotten married and I had my children. I had mm-hmm. three boys. Mm-hmm. And I just couldn't see myself after touring with my brothers all over the world, then coming home trying to support a solo career. I didn't see that possible. So I preferred to stay there and try to be a good father, right, you know, because the whole thing was that Black men have these babies and they don't take care of their family. They're not being men. I was trying to show that's not a true statement. Mm-hmm. You can't put us all in one bowl and say we're all alike, because we're not. So I preferred to do that. And then my sons had came over to see one of our concerts and they fell in love with the Jackson 5, of course, mm-hmm. the first time they saw him. They wanted, just like me, wanted to be like their father. They came home and grabbed brooms and mops and were dancing and singing our songs with the record on. And I said, you guys like what you're doing? Dad, we want to be like you and Uncle Michael and Jackie, etc. I said, well, you know what? We don't put on records when we sing on stage. We actually really play the music. We really be singing. Mm-hmm. And that takes time. You have to practice. So I turned them on to instruments, let them go into my studio, gave them pianos and synthesizers I had laying around, let them touch them and play with them. And I saw they were very serious about what they wanted to do. And so I decided, instead of me chasing my career, I'm going to help my sons get a career.
All right.
So that's what I did. I worked with my boys for many years. And we used to have a thing that we called family. Well, this when the family's coming over and the kids entertain for us. Mm-hmm. So they used to enjoy that. You know, they used to come over and do their little thing. You know, I'd come down with all their instruments and guitars packed in the back of my truck and go down to my mom's house and set up for them and that whole thing. And they perform for the family. And I was proud of that. You know, that I wasn't trying to go out and have my own hit record, although I knew I can do it, but I was trying to do the right thing, take care of my kids. And that's what I did instead of trying. This Tito Time record, I could have made 30, 40, 50 years ago.
Okay.
You know, but it wasn't, the timing wasn't right.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Just to remind your three sons, so TJ, Taj, and Tarell formed the R&B and pop music band, the 3T, that have hit the charts from mid-1990s.
Right.
Yeah. And so what are they up to now?
They're still performing and making music and doing their things together and solo, and solo artists as well. Okay. So,
all right. So Tito, what you're telling me is that December 2016 was finally Tito time.
Yeah, Tito time. Yeah. Well, what actually happened is, you know who Charles Barkley is?
Mm-hmm. Of course.
I think it was the Miami Heat that was playing in the game, and he said the Miami Heat had performed like how did he put it? Michael Jackson was Kevin Wade, I think it was on that team, and the rest of the team was like the Jackson 5. And then he went into a whole thing about Tito. If Tito wasn't in the Jackson 5, would you really miss him? Stuff like that. And I said, you know what? I don't want to go down it as a mystery where Jackson never recorded a record and why and all that stuff. But that kind of thing going around, I got to show the people I didn't record a record because it wasn't my time. Maybe mm-hmm. I just didn't want to or whatever, but I do have talent. I wanted to prove that.
I knew.
So that's one of the main reasons why I made Tito time for the record.
Okay.
Just so they could say, all Jackson members, brothers and sisters, have hit the charts, okay. And I did, you okay. know. So, I'm proud of my music. I'm proud of my record, and I love Charles Barkley, but he didn't know what he was talking about.
Mm-hmm. And last question I wanted to ask you, Tito: what projects are you working on right now?
Well, right now I've been B.B. King Blues Band, and with my brothers, of course. And that's basically where I am. And I have a blues album that I've had for this last year that I'm contemplating on about releasing, whether I want to release a blues album or an R&B album. I think I want to go in the blues area, mm-hmm. you know, and release my blues music. So I'm working on that right now.
All right. Cool. All right. So,
you know, I also, mm-hmm. I perform with the B.B. King Blues Band. We just finished a mass show in Kansas City. No, it was Topeka, Kansas. Mm-hmm. And I'm still working with them. So, you know, I'm trying to just stay busy.
So Tito, thanks for this conversation, and we definitely keep in touch.
Thank you very much for the interview.
You're welcome.